All right, so the next murmur we're going to look at is that of mitral regurgitation. And this is an extremely common murmur, which you will definitely hear within the first 10 to 20 patients you listen to on the wards. Now, mitral regurgitation, unlike aortic stenosis, will predictably be heard over the mitral area. So we're going to listen best to it down here at the apex. A note about the apex, by the way. You know, the aortic and pulmonic areas are very clear, right? They're just to the left and right of the sternum. They're at the second intercostal space. It's very predictable, a very discrete, specific location. The same thing goes with the tricuspid area, down here in the left lower sternal border at the approximately the fourth to fifth intercostal space. In contrast, the mitral area at the apex is really going to be different depending upon the patient. It's not going to be in exactly the same place, you know, 2 centimeters distal to the nipple line. It's going to vary depending upon the patient. So unlike finding these areas, when you're trying to look for the mitral area, you have to migrate around until you find the place where your mitral valve is loudest. So with that said, if I'm listening for a mitral regurgitant murmur, I'm going to be migrating around to find the place where it's loudest. Again, LISP, I is for intensity. The grade of this murmur, unlike aortic stenosis, does predict the severity of the mitral regurgitation itself and the extent of disease in the mitral valve, so intensity will matter. The shape for a classic mitral regurgitation murmur is so-called hollow systolic. That is, it's the same from beginning to end, and it may last for a short time in systole or throughout systole, but either way, it should be of a constant amplitude. So the typical onomatopoeia phrasing that we use to describe a mitral regurgitation murmur is also high in pitch, and it goes like this. And you can hear that it's the exact same amplitude, almost a square waveform in sound from one beat to the next. The timing, again, can occur throughout systole or early or late. Doesn't help too much with deciding the extent or severity of the mitral regurgitation so much as the amplitude or intensity or grade of the murmur would. So let me take a listen for mitral regurgitation. As it's high pitch, incidentally, you'll note that I'm using the diaphragm. And now let's say that I can sort of hear a murmur, but I'm not 100% convinced that it's there. Maybe it's a 1 out of 6 murmur. Or perhaps I'm worried that maybe this is just the murmur of aortic stenosis, which, as I said, could be all the way down there. Fortunately, in cardiology, there are a number of different bedside maneuvers that we can do, which predictably will increase or decrease the amplitude of a variety of murmurs. And so the first one of these that we're going to demonstrate is called the Handgrip maneuver. If you wouldn't mind grabbing that towel for us. So the Handgrip maneuver is designed to increase afterload. So when I have him squeeze that towel with all his might for 10 seconds, he's going to be contracting all the muscles in his upper extremities, which is going to increase peripheral vascular resistance. That means that when his left ventricle contracts and is trying to forcibly eject blood out of the aorta and out into his the great vessels of his upper chest and neck, there's going to be some resistance. And so if you already have a diseased mitral valve, when that left ventricle contracts and is trying to push blood outwards, some of it is going to get pushed backwards through an incompetent mitral valve. So this maneuver, hand grip, is an attempt to accentuate or exaggerate his mitral valve murmur, his mitral regurgitation. So let's give that a try. Importantly, I want him to do it for 5 or 10 seconds. Go ahead and squeeze it with all your might. Great. So in this case, fortunately, our patient does not have mitral regurgitation, but this would be the way to bring it out if I thought that it was going to be there.